How's it going, guys? We're here today with Creative Conversations with a good friend of mine, Zen Freeman. Zen, how's it going?
Hello, Ron. Very good, thank you. How you doing?
Good, good. It's great to see you. Looking healthy, looking great. We all just kind of came through quarantine period. I know you're over in California, and is it the West Hollywood or area? Or
Yeah, I'm in West Hollywood, home in LA with the family.
That's great, man. Staying healthy. So, you know, touching on, you know, what kind of stuff were you doing during the quarantine period?
Just really, you know, there's a lot of stuff going on in the world and trying to kind of see the silver lining, really. But I've been staying at home, staying healthy, eating clean, spending time with the family, just, you know, trying to kind of work on myself and be a better person.
Now, I'm excited. You know, we've got a mix that you put together that's going to air as part of this segment. And, you know, I remember bringing your name up as we started internally on my end. We started looking at, hey, who can we have be part of this series? And as we bring your name up, the next thing I know is you had one of your streams go live, and the guys just loved it. And you know, the thing is, I got a chance to get a sneak peek of the stream that's going to be coming out, and I'm really, really amazing. And I think the funny thing is when we were talking through it, you know, it looks like you had some heavy production value behind it, and you told me you ended up shooting it on a couple of iPhones.
Yeah, two tripods, two iPhones, and a light. And I've built like a little virtual nightclub in my, you know, in the corner of the studio.
Yeah, I was gonna say when I'm watching it, honestly, it made me feel like I was at a club and I'm sitting at a table watching a performance. So it was really, really cool. And honestly, I would say as part of the curation we've done production wise, probably one of the best productions I've seen. And again, I love the lighting elements. And I don't want to give too much away because, you know, but again, was really excited to kind of get that sneak peek.
Got it. Okay. Oh, thanks, mate.
So now you've been in kind of the California, Los Angeles area now for about, I don't want to age or date you, but probably about 20 years now.
Yeah. I mean, I came here, I was so young, I didn't really know how long I was going to stay, but it's been 20 years and I'm here. I've got my wife and my kids and they're in school, and it's really become a creative hub over the last decade. So it's just so great for what I'm doing. I couldn't think of a better place to be at the moment.
Now, you know, what got you, I'd say, you know, there's positions and points in our lives that we start on our journeys. And sometimes journeys kind of, you know, it's never a straight line, right? Sometimes, you know, we're trying to get to that career path and it's kind of all over, and we kind of get back to what we're excited about. But, you know, what got you into music? What got you into doing your craft?
Me? I mean, I was into sports as a kid, and then when I was at home, I used to take old record players and I used to help myself to my parents' vinyl, and I used to start mixing. And I was probably about 10 years old, 11 years old. I ended up getting some real turntables for my 15th birthday party, and I was DJing in clubs like shortly after. But, you know, I can remember my first, I was about 15 years old DJing in a club, and I didn't really, like, I knew how to mix, but I didn't really know how to use the gear in the club. Because I didn't have, you know, my mixer was a two-channel mixer, and they had a four-channel mixer. But I always kind of knew it was what I wanted to, it was, you know, it's what I love doing. I never saw it as, you know, as a career or a way of making money. In fact, it used to cost me money to go to the record store on, you know, every morning, Saturday morning, go to the record store, get the records home, then go play football.
You come over to the States, and when you first got here, were you DJing? Were you performing when you came over? Or
no, I wasn't actually. So I left London to go and work in. I went to work in Tokyo, and Sydney. Then I found my love for surfing in Bali. I was kind of working between the two, and the scenes over there were very different to the scene in LA. And I was playing a lot of, you know, electro house music at the time. And I came to LA I came here for 2 weeks to do a job. And then I went back to London decided that I wanted to come back to LA to experience it. And all these places, you know, I had a couple of boxes of records and I'd do a bit of this and a bit of that. It wasn't, you know, wasn't my main source of income at the time. And LA just blew me away, but I met, you know, I met Adam, you know, DJ AM, you know, God rest his soul, and Adam 12 and all these guys, you know, Dave Orlando, all these, Mark Ronson, and I just gave up at what they would do. They were pure turntablists. So when I moved to LA, I started working in PR, event production and experiential marketing, and really loved doing that. And it was a different, completely different angle to what I was doing before. But it was a blessing in disguise, because all those clients and, you know, and all the, you know, I got into consulting for luxury brands, those relationships kind of all started there. And then when I got into DJing, it was, you know, it was a lot easier. And I think I kind of saw a gap in the market for the sound, because there was, you know, there was a lot of, you know, unbelievable DJs who were very like upfront and kind of urban looking guys, but there was a lot of quite, you know, more sophisticated, laid back movie premiere events for, you know, big studio parties and Oscar parties. And I think they just wanted, it wasn't really about the music, it was more about the vibe. And, you know, I'd kind of show up with a, you know, with a black suit on and, you know, play tunes in the corner. And if they wanted it lower, I'd set the vibe. If they wanted to dance, I'd crank into fourth gear. So it was just kind of a natural progression.
Now you were, I mean, and again, I remember hearing about you for years and you playing these events. I mean, you've played a lot of the top A-list events that go on. I mean, you've done with the Oscars, right?
Yeah. I mean, I'm blessed really that I live in LA and I think I have good relationships. And there's a lot of things here, Oscars and Golden Globes. And I started off doing the film festival route, doing TIFF, Toronto Film Festival, Oscars, Cannes Film Festival. It's been really interesting actually. And then I do a lot of, it's almost, you know, consulting or music supervision for luxury brands, fashion brands like, you know, Chanel and Cartier and Burberry. But that can sometimes be creating playlists for activations, creating sounds for activations, or it could just be like a mobile DJ on the road with them and doing pop-ups and doing launch parties for stores. So yeah, we had a really, really good run.
Yeah, the thing that was always that always kind of drew me to you and was one of the things that I always liked was you really were connecting the three dots. I mean, you had these kind of events, you had the connection to fashion and music, and I always thought that was really, really cool. Like, I remember, I think it was reading something or seeing something that was connecting you with the Burberry brand, and I always just thought that was amazing. And then it was like, you know, again, being in Vegas, we hear a lot about what's going on in LA, and you see a lot of what's going on in the LA scene.
Right.
And we would hear about you playing again these events, and then again, like you mentioned, doing the cons event, and again coming outside of LA, but because of these connections and because of the vibe you were providing, now you're doing these things all over the globe that are connected to the film industry, which I always thought was amazing.
Used to be. We're taking a pause, but I've really enjoyed doing. I've always been very into doing music supervision and creating sounds and not always being the DJ that wants to kind of come in and rock it. Mm-hmm. I obviously love rocking a club, but I also like being an architect of sound and playing music for smart intellectuals and taking them on a journey, and doing, you know, seeing every event as, you know, from the specs to the sound system to what music I kind of deliver. And it's interesting. The club stuff, it's funny how it started, because I moved here, like I said, I almost gave up being a DJ. I, you know, turntables were gathering dust, and I used to love going to see AM, and I used to hang out and watch those guys play. But it was, it's funny because I actually first started DJing. I started doing a night about 15 years ago. This is before Steve Aoki and AM were doing Banana Split and these things. And I went on the Quagga Pass in Hollywood. I took a big, massive sound system, put it into a sushi bar, and played house music. But I kind of tricked the people that were coming to see me play into, I was playing kind of like open format remixes, but everything was 4 to the floor, like a house beat, more electronic beat. And then within a couple of months, this place had a line around the corner, and it was the place to be on Fridays. And that kind of got me back into it, you know. And then very quickly after that, I started doing a lot of film festival stuff, and then the fashion brands came in, and it all fell into part. And I kind of quit everything else I was doing and just focused on music.
Now, you know, you've had residencies with some of the top brands and venues in Las Vegas, and I remember you telling me the story that kind of then connected those dots. You know, I mean, think about it. You've had residencies with the Hakkasan Group. You had a residency with The Wynn, and then, you know, you even went over to be one of the foundational residents at Chaos, which unfortunately has since closed. But again, you've played at the top venues in Vegas. But I remember you telling me a great story that kind of connected that and was kind of like your kind of segue into Vegas.
Yeah, I mean, I think I was, you know, it's funny how it all kind of came around. So I started at the Palms, thanks to Paul Oakenfold, and I'll give you the story in a second. But yeah, kind of, you know, the last residency was at the Palms at Chaos. So I was DJing in a nightclub, and I was kind of doing this thing where, I was one of the first guys that was doing like a glitzy house night in LA, my kind of generation. But there was, yeah, about, you know, 14 years ago, I'm kind of playing house. About, I guess, Palms Law, I think Perfecto launched about, I think it was about 10 years ago, wasn't it? A decade. Wow, I'm getting old. So I was just smashing it in a nightclub, and I was covering a Wednesday night at my house for DJ AM. And there was 1,000 people squashed into this club, and there was everyone here. And Oakenfold came up to me and he said, "I love what you're doing, but just take all the house that you've done. We're opening a club in Vegas. Come play." And kind of took a risk, you know, as he took a risk when he did a night in Ibiza in 1989. And we went to Vegas together, and I never looked back. But it was being there at that pinnacle moment where nobody really trusted him. And I would listen to meetings that he was taking with the Nine Group that were running the club. And, you know, I can remember once they said, you know, Z-Trip and AM do Friday, how are you going to do a Saturday? Cut to 6,000, 7,000, 8,000 people trying to get into, you know, to see Paul play. And it was just interesting to be there for the whole run from start to close. And then, you know, and then once you do that, you experience all the, you know, the sounds and the people, the production, then it's easy to do it again. So then every time, you know, I got my agent, my first agent, and it was, you know, very different skill playing a room in Hollywood for 20 people or 300 people to playing, you know, week in, week out to 6,000 people. But yeah, you're right. It went from Palms to Marquee to, you know, to Hakkasan to Wynn, back to Palms.
I mean, it's just amazing. I mean, I remember at that point, the Palms and the Nine Group, they probably had the premier nightlife program in Las Vegas. When you look at, they were putting on real shows. I mean, the Friday night, you know, with DJ AM and Z-Trip, and then what you guys were doing on Saturday night was a real show. And I remember there being dancers and these production elements. And again, you were coming in for a real experience. And let's keep in mind, this is prior, you know, people used to use the word customer service back then, but no one was focusing on experience. And I remember going to these shows and it really was an experience, you know, and think about if that show launched today, or if social media would have been even more prevalent back then, how many more impressions and visibilities would have been on it.
Yeah.
No one in the world was doing what you guys were doing on Saturday night when you were doing it. It was so ahead of its time, because I mean, you've been around the club scene in Vegas. No one has even emulated to that level. I mean, sure, the club productions have gotten better over 10 years, but there was a real curation of what was going on, what you guys were doing. And I still, you know, when I look at, you know, my time in Vegas, which is also approaching 20 years, it's probably one of the more meaningful shows that have gone on.
Yeah. I mean, it was a massive club. It was, you know, the concept was obviously taken from Ibiza, and it was, you know, Ibiza was, you know, has been rocking since 1990. But I think Paul had, you know, Paul Oakenfold had the vision, and he saw the club and he saw the fire machine, and he kind of filled in the gaps. So what they weren't doing on Friday, on Saturday, he put in a whole troupe of off-duty Cirque du Soleil performers. Yeah. He's got trapeze artists up there, and he's got, you know, all sorts of acrobatics, and it was a show. It was a real show, and you cut, you know, you get that, you know, the music and the energy and the sound system mixed with the fire machine, and you know, and it was kind of the first time in the US I'd ever really seen what became, you know, exhibition. Exhibition elements and all the production and a hardcore dance crowd mixed with a bottle crowd.
You know, the thing is too, a lot of people don't understand the, I want to say, geography of Las Vegas, but you know, the Palm sits off the Strip, and again, we always talk, it's literally one bridge, right? There's literally Las Vegas Boulevard, there's a small bridge, and there's the Palm. And a lot of people, I think, don't understand how difficult it is sometimes to get people to go off the Strip. And I remember you guys were crushing it. I mean, the party again became the premier Saturday night in town in a very competitive marketplace at a property that many would have said it was a disadvantage because of where it was positioned. But you guys did amazing.
Correct, yeah.
And I remember that this is a time when athletes, celebrities, performing artists, they were all staying at the Palms. And I know a lot of them,
they killed it.
Yeah, they were frequenting the Friday and definitely the Saturday night shows. So it was really, you know, it's a meaningful time in Vegas. You know, I always say to myself that at some point someone's going to do some sort of documentary about the club journey in Las Vegas, and I believe that the Perfecto Party is going to be a big part of that docuseries or documentary, because it's definitely a story that needs to be told.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, it was definitely the seed to what became, you know, we never called it EDM back then. It was, we're going to do house. And Paul was like, you play house, I'll play trance. And it became, you know, and it was, that was it. That was the beginning and of the beast that it is today. And now it's everywhere. And it would be, you know, it would be strange if the DJs didn't play electronic dance music.
You know, I think we, you know, me and you have known each other a few years now, and obviously I've known of you for many years. And it's funny, I think I told you a story once. You know, we were doing campaign shoots, and when you signed to be a resident of Wynn, and the team on my side had probably, you know, we were doing probably about 20 to 30 shoots. We were doing all of the resident artists from, at that point, David Guetta to Chainsmokers to Virgil Abloh. And I remember the team was very intimidated coming into your shoot, you know? And again, we went through our process, and we had information about you, and obviously we knew who you were, but we get into a room and we start kind of Googling. And as we're Googling and trying to dissect, because again, we're trying to get a feel for your personality, and we're seeing all these great photos, and we're seeing all these things that are connecting you to fashion brands, you know, and now we're a little scared because again, like, you're one of the guys that we photographed. You are a model. You look like a model. So coming in, the team very intimidated. You know, standing there, and again, we didn't know your personality, and obviously 5 minutes in, we get to know you've got this you know, this great energy about you, just a great person. And again, but I remember like the team, you were the one guy that everyone was very intimidated coming into the shoot. And I remember the shoot just being amazing. And
it was a great shoot. Yeah, I had so much fun that day and it went like so quickly and everyone was, you know, you guys all kind of became, that was the beginning of a, you know, of a journey that we went on together.
The crazy thing was obviously, and you became one of the artists that I think we liked working with the most. And again, like the quality of shoot was just amazing. But again, coming into that, you know, the team was very intimidated. So it's awesome to tell that story now, you know, and again, we've developed a friendship over the years. So I feel comfortable telling you that. But it was at the time, I remember that the team was pretty scared. And
oh, thank you.
It was just an amazing day.
Very nice of you to say. And it's a great, that was a great, what a great resort. You know, everyone that worked there, that was, you know, on that club was on point. I love, you know, I really had a lot of fun there playing.
Yeah, you know, it's, you know, I spent over a decade of my life there and have nothing bad to say about the property. You know, the ideology and even when kind of, I would say, when some of the key figures kind of changed throughout the years, you know, they've done a great job of maintaining brand integrity. They've done a great job of just being pure class, you know, and I think it obviously, yeah. You know, it's a great, it still is an amazing property. I, you know, can't say a negative thing about the guys or the venues. You know, when we, as we look to the release of your set, you know, what kind of, you know, give us a little peek on your side, like of what we're going to hear. I mean, I've seen it, I loved it, but.
The stream, yeah, I just kind of put it together. I didn't want to give you a club set, so I just spent, you know, a few hours looking through playlists and thinking of some of the happy moments of live streaming at home or playing some songs that just come up on my iPhone and when I get in my car. I just kind of jumbled them all together, but I had a lot of fun doing it. So yeah, thank you. It's you know, it's like a mix of some my new single, a remix that I just finished, one of my tracks that I've been probably a year old, and then just some cool tracks that find that streaming music and playing club music, you don't get any of that warm bottom end like you get in the club. So it's a different vibe. So I'm just still trying to figure it out, but I tried to give you a little bit, you know, I put some 80s in there and some remixes of some 80s stuff. And I hope you like it.
I mean, like I said, I got the unofficial peek at some of it. So it's really amazing. I'm going to ask you, like, how do you balance everything? You know, because the truth is like you're traveling, you know, you're doing performances and shows, you're a father, you're a husband, and you're also producing music. And again, staying evolving and staying fit. Like, how do you do that? Because it's sometimes hard to schedule creativity. I always say that. Like, when you know you go in to produce music, you know, there's probably a process you have. There's probably a mindset you have to go into. And like, again, we all have, you know, positive variables in our lives. But you know, you've done a lot. You have a lot. How do you balance everything?
I think as you get older, you just have to work. You know, you just have to think of ways of being proactive and just working smart. I think that I was definitely, I mentioned to you before, you know, I was kind of getting a little bit burnt out from touring, and this pause has been, you know, I mean, there's, you know, so many terrible things going on in the world right now. But it was, for me, it was a really good time just to kind of take a pause, reflect, think about all the things I'm doing well. And then, you know, I definitely wasn't spending enough time with my kids. You know, diet and fitness came into it a lot. And yeah, just, you know, just really just working, you know, working smart. And it's been a really interesting time of, at first, you know, the March 12th, my agent called me and my reaction was, "Aah! No!" And he's like, you know, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, cancelled. You know, gosh, I don't even, you know, 50 shows cancelled. And, you know, a few had paid a deposit and the money's in escrow at William Morris. And just the shows are just wiped clean. And it was quite a shock to begin with. But then, you know, with 4 months later, I feel good. I feel really good. And I'm making really good music at the moment and learning new things and reading more books and doing all the things that, you know, I guess a normal guy does that doesn't spend his whole life on planes and hotel rooms and, you know, eating other food that other people make all the time. So it's been, you know, it's been really good.
Yeah, a lot of people, I think, on the outside just see the profile and glamour that comes with what you do. They don't understand that, you know, sleeping in different beds and doing shows, and then on top of that, it's like you've got to have some sense of, like, I guess you would say, mental and physical health and well-being. And then also you got to be creative because you're also working on producing and creating music. So it's, a lot of people don't realize the rigorous schedule that comes with the career path.
You kind of have to figure out a way of using the left side of the brain and the right side of the brain. And I try and schedule sessions where I can really focus on just making music. And, you know, it's been great with, you know, the guys we're working together on, you know, emailing, bouncing sessions back and forth. And my production partner's in Portland, Oregon, and I have a guy in New York, and I working on music with a guy in Paris and London. And it's just amazing to the stuff that we're doing and the way that the whole world is so assertively creating music and sharing ideas. But I find that you just, you know, you need to just stop. And then there's time when I spend a whole, you know, just, you know, I try and not do creative stuff and just work on the business, you know. And then other times I try not to even look at my phone, which is amazing at the moment because it's, you know, that sometimes problems will fix themselves if you don't look, you know, if you don't, you know, it's nice to sometimes just put my phone away for 24 hours and just focus on the kids.
So, you know, as we kind of, again, I love having conversations with you, and this has been amazing. I really want to touch on, you know, when you look at this journey you've gone on, you know, when we talk about, you know, leaving home and kind of doing this discovery journey and being in Bali and really seeing the world and then settling in and finding that the California was a good synergy fit for you and the career path you've gone on and the success you've found. Is there anything, if you could look back, you would tell that you know, that 20-some-year-old kid who's making or beginning this journey, or if there's someone at home watching, you know, what would you say to him? Because again, I feel that there's a critical moment in everyone's life, right, where you're sitting there and you know, sometimes doubt people around you, environment can sometimes stunt that confidence for to take that leap or to take that jump or that first step in that journey. And what would you say to that person?
My advice might not be the best because I kind of came here, I was so young, I came here just to have fun. And it's always been the silver lining for me that, you know, I got into DJing because it was fun. And I didn't think it was ever gonna be a way of making money. I thought I'd have to go and get a job so I could buy music and buy the hardware to be a DJ because I loved it. So, you know, be passionate about your passions and do it and don't give up. And, you know, I mean, I got my first gig in Las Vegas because I was basically playing, I was trying to, you know, break the system. I didn't, every nightclub in LA had a swing beat, a hip hop beat, and I wanted to break it and have a 4-to-the-4 beat. And then, you know, Oakenfold sees what I'm doing and he invites me to come and play in Vegas. So I think just take risks and don't give up. That would be my advice.
Well, again, always great to get to spend time with you. Hopefully soon we'll get to spend some time together either in you know, LA, California, or over here in Vegas. Getting a little jealous every time I see you. It feels like you're aging in reverse. So keep up whatever you're doing, buddy. Honestly.
Thank you. It's always great speaking to you, and I really look forward to seeing you. And I look forward to the opening, even though it's, you know, feels like a lifetime away. But I'm really, yeah, really excited. I love what you're doing, and I can't wait to get my virtual tour.
Well, I'm hoping that you'll be part of that opening as well. So again, thank you for spending the time with me today. Excited for the to see this on Tuesday night. So
thanks, Ben, mate. Thank you.
Thank you. Stay healthy. Stay safe.
Take care, brother. See you soon.
See
bye-bye.
You soon.
Bye.